Question number 82 says, a stack organized computer has which of the following instructions? So we have types of instructions, 0 address, 1 address, 2 address and 3 address instructions. So like this, we have the type of instructions, and on the basis of these, we have machines, okay, CPU organizations. So we can organize the CPU in 3 ways. Okay, this is known as CPU organization. So we can organize the CPU in 3 ways. First is stack organization. In stack organization, we have a memory stack, which is the part of memory, and the instructions are like this, push, pop and add. So if you want to perform any arithmetic operation, this arithmetic operation will pop 2 top operands from this stack and will perform the operation. So you do not need to specify any operand in this stack organization. That's why if you do not have any operand, the instruction will be zero address instruction. Okay, zero address means and without any operand. Okay, you do not need to specify any operand because add instruction will work on the stack. So you will pop top 2 elements from this stack and will perform the arithmetic operation on them. So on like this, we have accumulator organization in which all the data is available in the accumulator. And then we have general register organization. Okay, so general register organization can have any kind of instruction. For example, we can have one address instructions in this, for example, add R1. So add R1 will add anything value of R1 in the accumulator. For example, we can have two address instructions, add R1, R2. So like this, we can have any type of instructions in the general register. For example, add R1, add R1, R2 and add R1, R2, R3. So 3 address instructions, 2 address instructions and 1 address instructions are allowed in general purpose general register organizations. In accumulator organizations, all the operations are done on accumulator. So instructions in this are of one address. In accumulator, we have one address instructions. In general registers, we can have any type of instructions like 1, 2 or 3 addresses. But in stack organization, we have only 0 address instructions. Okay, 0 address. So this question is asking about the stack organization. So stack organizations is of the zero address type of instructions. Okay, we do not need to specify any operand in these instructions. That's why they are zero address instructions. So for the question number 82, the answer is A. Next question is which one is the correct translation of the following statement into mathematical logic? So the statement is none of my friends are perfect. Okay, none of my friends are perfect. So which of the following is the translation of this English sentence into the mathematical logic? Okay, so first one is not of, this is existential quantifier. That means there does not exist any person X which is my friend and which is perfect. So this is saying the simple thing, that is none of my friends are perfect. So B is saying let's eliminate the options. B is saying there exists a person X who is not my friend and is perfect. So this is false. Okay, this is saying there exists a person X who is not my friend but is perfect. Okay, so this is not related to this sentence, that is none of my friends are perfect. This is saying there exists a person X which is not my friend and who is not perfect. Okay, there exists a person X who is not my friend and is not a perfect. So this is also false. D says there exists a person X who is my friend and is not a perfect. Okay, it's not perfect. So this is using existential quantifier. This is also false. So A is saying there does not exist any person who is my friend and perfect. This is also saying the same thing, that is none of my friends are perfect. I do not have any friend. I do not have anyone who is my friend and who is perfect. Okay. So this option A is the correct translation of this sentence. That means there does not exist any person who is my friend and who is perfect. Question number 85 says, the power of a multi-tape Turing machine is greater than the power of a single-tape Turing machine. Okay, so single-tape Turing machine, okay, you can say single-tape Turing machine has the same power as multi-tape Turing machine. Okay, so they have the same powers. We can simulate the multi-tape Turing machine using the single tape, or we can implement the multi-tape Turing machine using the single tape Turing machine. How we can keep the same input tape, and we can have in single tape we have single read write head. Okay, we have only single read write head, but in this multi-tap Turing machine, we can have multiple read write heads which will be working simultaneously on the input tape. So like this, we can implement the multi-tap Turing machine using the single tap Turing machine. So that's how single tap Turing machine and multi-tap Turing machines have the same power. So A is also false. S1 is false. S1 is saying the power of multi-tap Turing machine is greater than the power of single tap Turing machine. Actually, they are the same power. So S2 is saying every non-deterministic Turing machine has an equivalent deterministic Turing machine. So this is true because the power of non-deterministic Turing machine and deterministic Turing machine is same. Okay, they have the same power. So this is saying which of the following is true. Only statement 2 is true. That is, option B is correct for this question. Which of the following is false? Okay, option A is saying interrupts which are initiated by an instruction. Okay, any interrupt which is actually initiated by instructions are software interrupts. This is true. Okay, this is true. Any interrupt which are caused by an instruction, for example, if you make a function call, that is a software interrupt. Okay, that interrupt is caused due to instruction execution. So that is a software interrupt. B is saying when a subroutine is called, the address of the instruction following the call instruction is stored in the stack pointer. So at the time of call, when you are calling a function, the value of program counter is pushed on the stack. Program counter holds the next instruction, which means the instruction followed by the call. And when you return from the function, what you do is you pop that value of program counter and start execution from the point where you left. So B is the right option. Okay, B is okay, B is true. So this is asking about the false. C is saying a microprogram which is written as zeros and ones is a binary microprogram. This is true. Okay, any microprogram which is written as 0 and 1 is a binary microprogram, or you can say machine microprogram. This is also true. So D is the right answer. None of them are false. Okay, none of the options. Question number 87 says if X is a one dimensional array, then star X plus I is same as star address of XI. So if you have anything like this x1, this is the array indexing. Okay, so this x1 can be written as value at x plus 1. Okay, value at x plus 1. For example, you have an array like this. The name of the array is x. Okay, so the name of the array is x, which means x is pointing to the base address of this array, and then x plus is pointing to the next element, and the x plus 2 is pointing to next element like this. So we have these memory locations. These are the memory locations x plus 1, x plus 2, x. So if you want to reach to the value of x plus 1, you have to add the star. You have to dereference this memory. Then you can say star x plus 1 is equals to x1, because this is the element at the location x1. This is x0. Okay. So x1 can be written as star x plus 1. If you have two dimension array like this x1 2, this can simply be written like this star x plus 1. X1 can be written as star x plus 1, and then this 2, or you can say this can be written as star x plus 1 plus 2. Okay, so this is same as x1 2. So option A is saying star x plus y is same as star address of xi. Okay, so this is true because this is saying the value at address of xi. So address of xi is, let's say, 2000, and the value of 2000 is xi itself. Okay, or you can say this is address operator, this is a dereferencing operator. So they can be cancelled out. So star x plus y is actually same as value at address of x plus I, xi. This is true. B is saying address of xi is same as x plus I minus 1. This is false, because address of xi is actually equal to double pointer. This will become double pointer. Star x plus I is same as value at xi. This is false, because star x plus y is actually same as xi, not star xi. Star x plus I is same as value at x plus y. This is also false. So A is the right answer for this question. Question number 88 is saying find the smallest number y such that y into 162, y multiplied by 162 is a perfect cube. What we mean by perfect cube? So any number which is a cube of any another number is a perfect cube. For example, if you look at 8, 8 is a perfect cube because this is the cube of 2. Okay. or you can say like 27 is a perfect cube because this is the cube of 3. Like this, 64. 64 is a perfect cube because this is the cube of 4. So these numbers are perfect cubes. So if we have a number like this, y into 162, to make it the perfect cube, what we need to do is, for example, 162 can be written as 2 into 81. Okay, y into 2 into 81, or you can say y into 2 into 9 into 9. So if you want to make it perfect cube, what you need to do is you need to take 3 2s and 3 9s. Okay, then this will be the cube of the 27. Okay, 18, that is 2 into 2 into 2. We have to add 2 2s and we have to add 1 9 to make it perfect cube. Now this is a perfect cube. If you take the cube of this, this will give you 2 into 9. Okay, take 2 from here and 9 from here, which means 18. So that will become the perfect cube of 18. Okay, this will become the cube of 18. So to make it perfect cube, you have to add 2 into 2 and 1 9. Okay, we have 2 into 9 into 9 already. So the value of y will be 2 into 2 into 9, that is 36. Okay, so that is option C is the right answer for this question. Question number 89 says, every relation in 3NF is also in BCNF. Is it true? Every relation which is in 3NF is also in BCNF. This cannot be true because we have more restriction on BCNF and less restrictions on 3NF. If you look at the normal forms, we have normal forms like this. This is BCNF, most restrictive. Then we have 3NF. Then we have 2NF and then 1NF, which is less restrictive. Any relation which is in BCNF is also in 3NF, in 2NF and 1NF. But any relation who is in 3NF may not be necessarily in BCNF. For example, we have any relation here. So this relation is in 3NF, but not in BCNF. Okay, this is not in BCNF. BCNF is only this. So this is false. B is saying a relation R is in 3NF if every non-prime attribute of R is functionally dependent on every key of R. This is the definition of partial dependency. Okay, so if we do not have any partial dependency in the relation, then this is always in 3NF. This is false because this is the definition of 2NF. This relation is always in 2NF, but any relation who is in 2NF is not necessarily in 3NF. Okay, but in every relation which is in 3NF is also in 2NF. According to this diagram, you can see. So this relation is actually in 2NF. This is the definition of 2NF, but it is not necessary that all the relations which are in 2NF are also in 3NF. Okay, but all the relations which are in 3NF are also in 2NF. C is saying every relation in BCNF is also in 3NF. This is true. Okay, every relation which is in BCNF is in 3NF, in 2NF also. So no relation can be in both BCNF and 3NF. This is false. We can have relations which are in both BCNF and 3NF. So C is the right answer for this question. Question number 90. We have instruction INCA, that is increase register A by A1, is an example of which of the following addressing modes. Okay, we have an instruction INCA. So as you can see, you do not have any operand in this instruction, and operand is itself in the operand, in the opcode. If we have any operand inside the opcode, that addressing mode is also is known as implied addressing mode. Implied addressing modes means the operand is implied itself from the opcode. Okay, operand is implied inside the opcode. INCA means increment accumulator by 1. So this is the example of implied addressing mode. Question number 91 says, which of the following is a correct hierarchical relationship of the following, where L1 is set of languages accepted by NFA, L2 is set of languages accepted by DFA. We know that L1 is equal to L2 because all the languages which can be accepted by NFA can also be accepted by DFA because we can convert NFA to DFA. So the language of NFA and DFA is same. 3 saying set of languages accepted by DPDA. Okay, which means these are the languages which are DCFLs. So regular languages are always subset of DCFLs. Okay, so they are subset of L3. L3 is DCFL. L1 and L2 are subset of L3 because L3 is DCFL and L1 L2 are regular languages. L4 is saying set of languages accepted by NPDA. So the power of DPDA and NPDA are different. NPDA is more powerful than DPDA, so the language accepted by them are different. So DPDA is actually the subset of NPDA. So all the languages which can be accepted by DPDA can also be accepted by NPDA. But all the languages which are accepted by NPDA is not necessarily accepted by DPDA. So that's why L4 is actually, L3 is a subset of L4. Okay, L3 is subset of L4 because L3 will accept the less number of languages than L4 because L4 is NPDA. L5 is set of recursive languages. Okay, so CFLs and DCFLs are subset of recursive languages. Recursive languages. Then L5 is set of recursive languages. Okay, this is done. L5 is set of recursive languages. This is L5. Then last is L6, that is set of recursively enumerable languages. So recursive languages are subset of recursively enumerable languages, that is L6. If you draw the diagram for languages, it will be like this. We have regular languages, then we have DCFLs, then we have CFLs, that is non-deterministic CFLs, and then we have recursive. These are the recursive languages, and then we have recursively enumerable languages. So all the regular languages are also DCFLs, CFLs, recursive and recursive enumerable. But all the DCFL languages are not recursive languages. Like this, all the CFL languages are not DCFLs, but we have some languages which are CFL but not DCFL. So this is the subset diagram. Okay, from this diagram you can draw the conclusion that L1 and L2 are equal because they are here. Okay, we have DFAs and NFAs here which accept the regular languages which are subset of DCFLs, that is L3. DSFLs are subset of CFLs, and CFLs are subset of recursive languages, and recursive languages are subset of recursively enumerable languages. So this is the correct order, correct hierarchy of the languages. So L1, L2, subset of L3, subset of L4, subset of L5, subset of L6. This is true. L1 is subset of L2. This is saying the languages accepted by NFA and DFA are different. Okay, this is saying the languages accepted by DFA are subset of NFA. This is false because they accept the same languages. L2 subset of L1, this is also false. Actually, L1 and L2 are equivalent. Only option A is correct. Question number 92 is saying, if for a given binary search tree, the pre-order traversal is this, then which of the following is its post-order traversal? So this is binary search tree. Okay, this is binary search tree. If you traverse the binary search tree in order, it will always give the increasing order of elements. For example, pre-order is already given. Pre-order is given, that is 41, 23, 11, 31, 62, 50 and 73. Then in order is, we can conclude that in order will always be the increasing order. Okay, increasing order. For example, first element will be 11, then we have 23, then we have 31, 41, then we have 50, 62 and 73. This is really the in order traversal. So we can draw the binary search tree according to these two traversals. In this case, pre-order means we have parent, then left subtree, then right subtree. In case of in order, first we access the left subtree, then parent, then right subtree. So like this we can find the parent. Parent will be 41 according to in pre-order, and according to in order it will also be 40. So 40 will be the root of the tree. Then in left we have 11, 23, 31. In right we have 650. All the elements which are greater than 41 will be in the right hand side because this is binary search tree. Then 23 will be the root of the subtree of 41. Left child will be 11 and right child will be 31. So this is the tree. This can be constructed from these traversals. So we can find the posterior traversal of this tree. We have final tree, and this will be the unique binary search tree. Okay, so this is unique binary search tree because pre-order and in-order traversals are given. So if you traverse this tree in the post-order means what will be the post-order traversal? Post-order means first you will access the left subtree, and then right subtree, and then child, and then parent. So first access the left subtree. In left we have subtree, that is first we will access 11. Then we will access right subtree, that is 31, then parent 23. This subtree is finished, then we will go to the right child of the 41, that is 62. So this will also be a subtree. In this subtree we will apply the post order traversal, that means first we will access the left child, that is 50, then we will access the right child, then we will access the parent, that is 62, and the parent of the complete tree, that is 41. So this will be the post order traversal for this tree, that is 11, 31, 23, 50, 73, 62, 41. So option A is the matching option for this question. Question number 93 says the total number of page faults for the reference string 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10 using FIFO page replacement policy for a process if 3 frames are allocated to it. So you do not need to solve this question. By directly looking at the reference string, you can say all of them will be a page fault. So all of these accesses will result in page fault. Why? Because all the values are different. We do not have any string which is accessed twice. So that's why number of page faults will be 10. Without solving this question, you can say the number of page faults will be 10 because all the strings are different. Or if you want to look at the solution, you can say like this. We have 3 frames. Okay. So access 1. 2, 3, they are page faults. 1, 2, 3 are page faults. Now you will access 4, but this memory is already full, so you have to replace one of the pages using the FIFO algorithm, first in first out. So 1 came first, it will be first out. Then you will access 5 will also be a page fault because this is coming for the first time. 6 will also be a page fault because this is coming for the first time. Like this, 7 will also be a page fault which will replace 4. 8 will also be a page fault. 9 will also be a page fault, and 10 will also be a page fault. So all of these are page faults. So number of page faults are 10. So B is the right answer. Question number 94. This question says in conservative two-phase locking protocol, a transaction. Okay, what is conservative two-phase locking protocol? Conservative two-phase locking protocol says that this is the modification in the two-phase locking protocol to prevent the deadlock. Okay, so this scheme is first thing is deadlock free. How we make it deadlock free is we put a restriction and we says that restriction is this, like any transaction which want to execute will lock all the locks, all the items before starting the execution. Okay, so whenever any transaction want to execute, it will actually lock all the items. It will acquire all locks before execution. All locks means read lock as well as write lock. Okay, exclusive lock as well as shared lock. So you have to acquire all the locks before starting the execution of the instruction. This is the restriction put in the conservative two-phase locking to prevent the deadlock. So A is saying should release all the locks only at the beginning of transaction. This is false. You cannot release any lock in the beginning, because in two-phase locking protocol, first you lock all the values, then you release all the values. B is saying should release exclusive locks only after the commit operation. Okay, this is the definition of strict two-phase locking protocol, not conservative. C is saying should acquire all the exclusive locks at beginning of the transaction. Okay, this is not true. Actually, this is true. Should acquire all the locks. What is the difference between C and D? Should acquire all the exclusive locks. Okay, we are saying actually in conservative two-phase locking protocol, you have to lock all kind of locks. It may be shared, it may be exclusive. So the appropriate option for this question is D. Question number 95 says if the number of networks and the number of hosts in class B are 2 to the power m and 2 to the power n minus 2 respectively, then the relation between m and n is what? So if you look at the class B, so the architecture of class B is like this. First 2 bits are reserved and we have given 16 bits to NAT ID. Okay, 16 bit to the NAT ID and 16 bit to the host ID. So IP address is of 32 bits. We know that IPv4 is of 32 bits and they are divided into two parts, that is NAT ID and host ID. Because these two bits are reserved in the class B, so you do not have any choice for these two bits. So number of networks allowed in class B is, we can form the networks from 14 bits because 2 bits are already taken, they are reserved. The total are 16 bits, 2 bits are reserved, so you can form the networks from 14 bits. So number of networks are possible is 2 to the power 14 and number of host possible is always 2 to the power 16 and you have to separate minus 2. For first address in any network is used for the NAT ID and last IP address within the any network is used for broadcast. That's why we subtract 2. So in this question, number of hosts in class B are 2 to the power m and number of networks are 2 to the power m and number of hosts are 2 to the power n minus 2. So you can put number of networks are 2 to the power 14 equals to, given is 2 to the power of my, 2 to the power m. So the value of m is 14 from this equation. Okay, number of hosts are given 2 to the power n minus 2. So the value of 2 to the power n minus 2 is actually 2 to the power 16 minus 2. Or you can say 2 to the power n equals to 2 to the power 16. Which means n equals to 16. So what is the relation between n and m? So option A says 3m equals to 2n. If you say 3m is 14 equals to 2 into 16. Okay, this will be 42 and this will be 32. They are not equal. So this is false. If you take B is saying 7m. 7 into 14 equals to 8 into 16. Because the value of n is 16, we have found out. So this will be 118 and this will be 98 and this will be 128. So they are not equal. So B is also a false. So C is saying 8m equals to 7n, which means the value of m is 14, that is 8 into 14 equals to 7 into 16. Let's look at this one. This will be 1112 and this will be 1112. So they are equal. Okay, they are equal. 112 equals to 112. So this is the right relation between m and n. 8m equals to 7n. 2m equals to 3n. This will give 2 into 14 equals to 3 into 16, which means 28 and this will give 48. They are not equal. So this relation is also false. Question number 96 says, which of the following is equivalent regular expressions? Okay, equivalent regular expressions. 1 is 01 star, 10 star, the whole star, and second is 10 plus 01 star. If you look at this, this is 01, this is 10, and this is 01, this is 10. So this simply, if you can say like this, P star, this can be written, let's say this is P and this is Q. So this is saying P star, Q star, whole star, and we know that if we have any regular expression like this, we can say P plus Q star, they are equivalent, okay. According to the properties of regular expression, they are equivalent. So option 1 and 2 are equivalent. Okay, this is P and this is Q. So Q plus P or P plus Q are same. Okay, this can be written as Q plus P star. If I take 10 as Q and 01 as P, this is P and this is Q. They are equivalent. P plus Q star equals to, you can write P star, Q star, whole star. Okay, they are same. C saying 01 star plus 11 star, they are not equal to any of these. Okay, this is not equal to any of these because this is 11 star, this is different. 4 is saying 0 star plus 11 star plus 0 star star. So from this you can generate 01 or you can generate 11. 0101, 1111. From this you can generate single zeros and double ones, but from this you cannot generate single zeros. Okay, that will be the pair of 01 or 11s. So 01s, zeros cannot be generated from this, so they are not equivalent. Okay, so their 1 and 2 are equivalent, that is option is correct. Question number 97 says, consider a complete binary tree where the left and right subtrees of the root are max heaps. Okay, we have a binary tree, that is complete binary tree, In which left and right subtrees of the root are heaps, max heaps, the lower bound for the number of operations to convert the tree to a heap. Okay, we have a complete binary tree, and actually this is not a complete heap, but we have a node for which right subtree and left subtree is max heap. For example, this is left subtree and this is max heap, in which root is greater than, okay, parent is greater than both of the childs. Okay, this is max heap because the parent is greater than left and right childs. And this is second node, that is right node, and right node is also a max heap. This is given, right subtree and left subtree are max heap of the root. So let's say this is also a max heap. These left subtree and right subtree are max heap, but this complete tree is not a max heap. You have to convert this complete tree into max heap because this is 10, which is less than the left child and right child. So if you want to make it max heap, you have to replace it with one of the its childs, okay, with one of the childs. So you can, if you make one swap, you have to make one swap like this, because left is greater than right and right is greater than parent. So if you replace this, you have to make one swap. This will be 10, 35, 27. So you do not need to go in this direction. Then 25 and 20. Now you have to make one more swap, which means, because this left subtree is not a max heap now, you have to make it sub max heap. So you can replace this with 25, 40, 25, 35, and 10, 20. So this will be the final max heap after the swaps. So it took only two swaps, one here and two here, and as you can see, that height of the tree is 2. Okay, the height of the subtree is 2, and we know that the height of complete binary tree is log base 2 n. So you have to make number of comparisons equals to height of the tree to convert this tree into heap, max heap. So the answer for this question is A, that is log n. You need only log n swaps to convert this complete binary tree, in which left subtree is a max heap, right subtree is a max heap, but complete tree is not a max heap. So you require only two swaps. Okay, either you will go in this direction or you will go in this direction. Question number 98 says, which machine is equally powerful in both deterministic and non-deterministic? So if you look at the machines, NFA and DFAs are equal of the same power. Okay, NFA and DFA are the same powers in terms of powers. But in case of non-PDA, okay, non-deterministic PDA, it has the more power than deterministic PDA. Okay, because the language, the set of languages accepted by non-PDA is actually the superset of DPDAs. Then we have Turing machines and linear bounded automata. In case of linear bounded automata, they accept the CSLs, context sensitive languages. The power of non-deterministic linear bounded automata and deterministic linear bounded automata, the power is same. Okay, in case of Turing machine, the power of Turing machine is equal to the power of non-deterministic Turing machine. They are same in the power. Okay, so option A is pushdown automata, no, because the non-deterministic version and deterministic version of the PDA have the different powers. Okay, because NDPDA is having the greater power than DPDA. In case of Turing machine, this is okay. The Turing machine deterministic version and non-deterministic version of Turing machines have the same power. In case of linear bounded automata, they are having the different powers. Okay, the power of non-deterministic linear bounded automata is greater than the linearly bounded automata. Okay, so option B is correct for this question. Question number 99 says, which of the following is are not features of RIC processors? RIC processors, we have two type of processors, RISC and CISC. If you compare them, in case of RICs, we have more number of registers and we have less number of addressing modes. Okay, if you look at the instruction set architecture of RIC and CISC, in RIC we have more number of registers and less number of addressing modes, and one more the advantage of this RIC processor is we have fixed length of instructions. Okay, fixed length instructions, which means we can have one instruction which is actually equal to the one word. So you do not need to access multiple words of memory to access an instruction. And one more advantage is that you can increment the program counter with a fixed value, because the instructions are of fixed length. So you can increment the program counter with a fixed value. Okay, then CPI of RISC processes are 1, which means cycles per instruction for each instruction is 1. Each instruction is taking on average 1 cycle. And in CISC, we have all the characteristics opposite to RISC, which means we have less number of registers in the CISC processor. We have more number of addressing modes. We have variable length instruction in CISC. And CPI is not equal to 1. So all the opposite characteristics of CISC in opposite of RISC. So A is saying large number of addressing modes. This is the characteristic of CISC, not of RISC. So this is not a feature of RISC processor. Uniform instruction set, this is the feature of RISC processor, but this is asking about not the feature. So this is okay. So only one is not a feature of the RISC. This is the feature of CISC. So only one is correct. Question number 100. This question says, which of the following is true? A is Miele and Moore machine are language acceptors. Okay. Miele and Moore machines are the machines with outputs. And we do not have any initial or final states in the Miele or Moore machine. Okay. These are the languages with machines with output. Okay, so in this Miele machine, the output depends on the current state and the input symbol. In Moore machine, output depends on the current state only. So they are actually not machine acceptors, they are actually machine translators. They are actually language translators. Okay, they are translators, not the acceptors. DFA and NFA are acceptors. Okay, but B is saying finite state automata, that is DFA and NFA, is language translator. They are not language translator, they are actually acceptors. Acceptors. So that's why A and B both becomes false. C is saying NPDA is more powerful than DPDA. So we have seen this many times in this video, that NPDA is having the more power than DPDA. They accepts CFLs and they accept DCFLs, and the closure properties of DCFL and CFLs are different. So this is true. NPDA is more powerful than DPDA. D is saying Miele machine is more powerful than Moore machine. This is false, because we can convert any Miele machine to Moore machine and Moore machine to Miele machine. So that's why Miele machine and Moore machines are of same power, not of different powers. So C is the right answer for this question.